Samuel Alexander, 1859 to 1938. Shyamasundar Das. Alexander is the philosopher of emergent evolution. For him, external objects have an existence independent of consciousness. Unlike many other philosophies, Alexander's neo-realism contends that something may exist even though it is not perceived. Srila Prabhupada, yes, that is so. God exists whether we perceive him or not. God is the original creator, and just as everyone has a father, all living entities are coming originally from this original father. The father is there. Fact is fact, whether anyone perceives it or not. You may not have seen my father, but you know that I had a father. You do not have to perceive him directly to know that he is a fact. Because I exist, my father is essential. That is understood and assumed by everyone. Therefore, people say, "What is your father's name?" Instead of, "Do you have a father?" It is assumed that one has a father, even though his father is not immediately perceived. Shyamasundar Das. Alexander uses the example of a house, whether we are conscious of a house or not. The house itself is a real entity, unaffected by our awareness of it. It has a real objective existence. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, as far as that proposition is concerned, if we accept the fact that we are eternal, it is very natural to assume that we have an eternal house, an eternal home. That is, back home, back to Godhead. When people ask, "Where do you live?" they are asking for your residence. Your present address may not be your birthplace, but it is a fact that we must live somewhere. No one may be interested in knowing where I live, but everyone knows that I have a place to live. Shyamasundar Das. Alexander believes that our consciousness of an object gives us only limited perspective. When we shift our position, our perspective changes. If I see a table, that table has an objective reality. It is not just a mental image. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, you cannot say that the table is just a mental image. If someone throws the table and knocks you down, you will bleed. That is not simply mental. Shyamasundar Das. Alexander also claims that even illusions or hallucinations are genuinely real objects. If I think I see a snake, which is really a rope, the illusion of that snake is real. Srila Prabhupada. There is in reality a snake, otherwise how can the image of a snake come to the imagination? I may falsely take a rope to be a snake, but that doesn't matter. In reality, the snake exists. Shyamasundar Das. For Alexander, the mind never creates anything new, but rearranges things. Since everything already exists, there is no question of creating anything. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, you cannot create anything. You can only transform. This table is nothing but wood. The wood is not my creation. It is already there. I have only transformed the wood into a shape called a table. It is said that necessity is the mother of invention. When I need something to sit on, I invent a chair. Shyamasundar Das. Some philosophers reason that because man feels a necessity for God, he has invented God. Srila Prabhupada. Not invented. He knows God, and this is perfectly natural. Any sane man would ask, "Who is the original father?" There is no question of inventing the original father. Anyone can understand that there is an original father by philosophical research. The Vedanta Sutra states, "Janmadi asya yata." God is the original father of everyone. Invention refers to a thing that I create which was not in existence, and discovery refers to something I find that is already there. Invention and discovery practically convey the same idea, because nothing is new. In the case of God, it is discovery. There is no question of invention. Hayagrivadas. In his major work, Space, Time, and Deity, Alexander writes, "Religion leans on metaphysics for the justification of its indefeasible conviction of the reality of its object, God. Philosophy leans on religion to justify it in calling the possessor of deity by the religious name of God. The two methods of approach are therefore complementary." Srila Prabhupada. We have often said that philosophy without religion is mental speculation, and religion without philosophy is sentiment. The combination of the two is most desirable. Bhagavad Gita is religion and philosophy combined. Religion is explained in terms of worship of God, and philosophy is explained in terms of the immortality of the soul and other subjects. Thus, Bhagavad Gita is the supreme combination of religion and philosophy. Hayagrivadas. If religion is like hunger, God is the food for that hunger. Alexander writes, "This religious appetite may either be stirred in us directly by the impact of the world with its tendency to deity, or it may first be felt by us as a need of our nature." Srila Prabhupada. We are seeking love of God beginning with our own body. We love this body because we live within it, and as long as the living soul is there, the body has value. The living soul is valuable because he is part and parcel of God. We also understand from Bhagavad Gita that within the body, God is also living. So within, there are two kshetrigyas, one who knows the individual body and the other who knows all bodies. The ultimate conclusion is that because the supreme living entity, God, is within the body and within the universe, we are attracted by love, society, friendship, communalism, and nationalism. When all this culminates in love for God, we attain perfection. We are searching for love of God, but we are moving by degrees from one platform to another. Hayagrivadas. Alexander writes, "It is idle to hope that by defining God in conceptual terms, whether as the sum of reality or the perfect being, or the first cause, or by other device, we can establish the connection between such a being and the rest of our experience. We do but start with an abstraction, and we do but end with one. Proofs of God's existence in nature there are none, if such a God is to be identified with the object of worship." Srila Prabhupada. We can understand the presence of God in nature, and we can certainly see his presence there. We can understand that there is a proprietor of the land, sea, and air. We may not be able to see the proprietor of the universe, but from our present experience with proprietorship, we can understand that there must be an ultimate proprietor. God is the proprietor of the sun, moon, and the sky itself. Vedic literatures describe the moon as the mind of God, the sun as the eyes of God, the land as the food of God, and the waters as the semen of God. This is the beginning of impersonal realization, but we should understand that there is a person in the background. Although we have not seen the governor of Hawaii, we can understand that he is present by seeing the different branches of government. Similarly, as long as we are not qualified to see the supreme personality of Godhead, we can understand that this is God's hand, and this is God's heart, his mind, his eyes, and so on. When we are qualified, we can personally see God face to face. Hayagriva Das. Alexander felt that even the description of God is full of figurative language. For him, it is impossible to describe God. Srila Prabhupada. If it is impossible, why is he trying? Why shouldn't we accept the Vedic descriptions? In Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna tells Krishna, Param Brahma Param Dham Pavitram Paramam Bhavan Purusham Shashvatam Divyam Adi Devam Ajam Vibhum Ahustvam Rishaya Sarve Devarshir Naradastata Asito Devalo Vyasa Svayam Chaiva Bravishime. You are the Supreme Brahman, the ultimate, the supreme abode and purifier, the absolute truth, and the eternal divine person. You are the primal God, transcendental and original, and you are the unborn and all-pervading beauty. All the great sages such as Narada, Asita, Devala, and Vyas proclaim this of you. And now you yourself are declaring it to me. Bhagavad Gita 10th chapter verses 12 to 13. If all authorities accept Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, what further evidence do we need? No further argument is necessary. Things should be simplified. Shyamasundardas. The mind is always reorganizing existing things. New comes from old, and from this, Alexander draws his idea of evolution. Srila Prabhupada. Since there is gold and mountains, I can imagine a gold mountain. I can combine many ideas with my imagination. The mind creates some ideas, and then rejects them to create others, and then rejects them also. The mind is not satisfied with creating something final. The mind, by nature, is creative. It creates something, then thinks, oh, this is not perfect, and then begins again. That is the mind's business, accepting and rejecting. Shyamasundardas. For Alexander, the mind has two functions, contemplation and enjoyment. Contemplation involves perceiving the qualities of an object, for instance, an apple's redness. Srila Prabhupada. Or if I see a tamarind, I immediately salivate. Shyamasundardas. Enjoyment involves a mental awareness of inner physiological activity. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, there are many examples. One may dream of a sex object and have a nocturnal discharge. The mind creates things in this way, and there are actual physical reactions. In a dream, the mind may create a tiger, and the dreamer may cry aloud in fright, but actually there is no tiger. Shyamasundardas. Alexander believes that even these dream images have an objective reality in our consciousness. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, when I dream of a woman or a tiger, they exist in objective reality. The impressions in my mind are created hallucinations, but they may evoke physical reactions. Shyamasundardas. Alexander describes time as an infinity of single instants, and space as an infinity of points. Together they constitute primordial reality. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, we also consider time and space to be reality. Time is eternal, and therefore we take time to be another feature of God. Space is a later creation. Space is prakriti. Prakriti refers to nature. The elements, like earth, water, fire, ether, space. Space or sky is one of the fundamental factors of prakriti. Prakriti, Kala, Jiva, Bhagavan, nature, time, individual soul, and God. These are all realities, and they are all eternal. there is only one ultimate creator, Bhagavan, and the Jivatma, the individual soul, is the subsequent creator. God creates wood, and from this wood I create a table or a chair. Thus I am the subsequent, not the ultimate creator. Both creators, Bhagavan and Jivatma, are eternal, but because the creation has a past, present, and future, time is also eternal. Shyamasundara Das. Is there such a thing as spiritual space? Srila Prabhupada. Of course. If not, how could there be a spiritual world? The quality is different, but the ingredients are exactly the same. Shyamasundara Das. Alexander, like Bergson, also believes that nothing remains at rest, that everything is in perpetual transition. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, we also accept that. Everything is going forward. That is called Jagat. Shyamasundara Das. Can this be said of the activities in the spiritual world? Srila Prabhupada. We are speaking of the material world. The spiritual world is different. In the spiritual world, activities are eternal. In the material world, they are not. Shyamasundara Das. But isn't the motion of everything eternal? Srila Prabhupada. That motion is the interaction of the three modes, goodness, passion, and ignorance. In course of time, these modes react, and creation takes place. There is certainly motion. Without motion, there cannot be creation. Material nature is composed of earth, water, fire, ether, and space. Whatever you see is composed of one or more of these ingredients. There are also subtler ingredients, mind, intelligence, and ego. These are the eight material elements given in Bhagavad Gita, and they are considered the differentiated energy of Krishna. Shyamasundara Das. Alexander's primary category is more abstract. He says that it is motion. Srila Prabhupada. But where does the motion come from? Motion means that there must be someone there to push. Shyamasundara Das. Another major category is identity, or diversity. Everything has a personal identity, an individuality differentiating it from every other thing. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, that is called sajatiya vijatiya in Sanskrit. There is difference, vijatiya, even between like things. There may be two mango trees, but there is still a difference between them. They may be one as mango trees, but there is still individuality. Similarly, my fingers are one, but each finger is different from the other. Sajatiya refers to the same category. But even within that category, there is a difference. Shyamasundara Das. Existence or being is another major category. Srila Prabhupada. That existence is composed of one or more of the five elements. One ingredient may be more prominent than the other, but there is at least one ingredient. Shyamasundara Das. Relation and order are other categories. Everything relates to everything else, and there is order in everything. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, there is certainly order in Prakriti. The sun rises and sets at designated times. There is order everywhere. Shyamasundara Das. The mind also occupies space and works in time. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, we are occupying space, and since the mind is within us, the mind also occupies space. From practical experience, we can understand that the mind can immediately travel thousands of miles with no difficulties. Shyamasundara Das. But is that distance within me, or does my mind actually travel there? Srila Prabhupada. It travels. It actually occupies space. Unless it occupies space, how could it travel? It travels so fast that you can't exactly remember how it is going, but as soon as it reaches its destination, you can apprehend it. In any case, it occupies space. Shyamasundara Das. The mind can leave the body and go somewhere? Srila Prabhupada. Not leave. It is just like a shoot. It extends. At night, when we are dreaming, the subtle body also extends and comes back again. In fact, we may take the subtle bodies in dreams to be very important at the time. Shyamasundara Das. Alexander maintains that new categories are constantly being uncovered because evolution is progressing. The living entity can evolve into new forms that we now know nothing about. Srila Prabhupada. No, we do not agree. We know that the days are going on now and will continue, just as we have experienced them in the past. In the past, there was summer, autumn, winter, and spring, and in the future, these will also be experienced. Of course, the old order changes and yields to the new, but from our past experience, we know what will be there. Shyamasundara Das. Then in the future, there will be nothing unpredictable appearing, such as an entirely new form of existence? Srila Prabhupada. No, why should there be? Why should there be a winter without spring, or a spring without summer? Why should there be a new type of man, a new species? According to the Vedic version, everything is here. The number of species in the water, in air, and on land is fixed. There is no question of the species increasing. Shyamasundara Das. Some scientists predict that the future man will have no bodily hair, that his head will be very large due to increased brain capacity, that the rest of his body will be atrophied, that he may lose some of his toes, and so on. Srila Prabhupada. This is more foolishness. There has never been such a thing, nor will there ever be. Man has always had 10 toes, and he always will. Shyamasundara Das. Alexander believes that man may evolve to the demigod platform in the future, that he may have super consciousness. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, that is possible. Yanti Deva Vrta Devan. Bhagavad Gita, 9th chapter, verse 25. If you are fond of the demigods, you will go to the demigods. Petran Yanti Petra Vrta. Bhagavad Gita, 9th chapter, verse 25. Or you can go to the ancestors, or remain within this material world. Shyamasundara Das. But Alexander thinks that evolution is moving in this way, progressing from inorganic life to organic to mental and to demigod. Srila Prabhupada. How can life come from inorganic matter? That is nonsense. What evidence do we have that life is developing from inorganic matter? If that is the case, why don't they manufacture life in the laboratory? Living force cannot be produced from matter. Matter is different from living force, or soul. Of course, in one sense, they are both the energy of God, but categorically they are different. You cannot even manufacture an ant. You may have all the chemicals, but you cannot inject the soul. The soul appears in different ways. For instance, fermentation, perspiration. When rock and water decompose, there may be fermentation. And it may be possible that the soul takes advantage of this and comes out, being born in some life form. In any case, life never comes from matter. It is thought by the foolish that scorpions are born out of rice. But actually the scorpion lays its eggs within the rice, and by the fermentation or heating of the rice, the eggs incubate, and scorpions are born. but this does not mean that matter itself is producing life. The Vedas accept the fact that living creatures can arise from fermentation, but this is only because the soul finds refuge there. Shyamasundar Das. But what of the idea that nature is progressing? Will man someday evolve to the demigod stage? Srila Prabhupada. According to the Vedas, the demigods were created before men. First, Lord Brahma was created, and from Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva was created. By created, I mean born. Similarly, from Brahma, others came, the Prajapatis, and then the Manus. There were many. There is no question of these personalities emerging from inorganic life. Lord Brahma came from the navel of Vishnu. You may ask, what is the origin of Vishnu? We have no information of this because Vishnu is the origin, and it was from him that Brahma and all the other demigods came. Then the animals and others came. The first created being is Lord Brahma, and he is also the most intelligent. It is not that he evolved from animals or men. These evolutionists propose that life evolves from the lowest to the highest, but we believe that it begins with the highest, with Vishnu. Krishna says, Aham Sarvasya Prabhava, I am the origin of everything. Bhagavad Gita 10th chapter verse 8. How can you say that higher species will develop from the lower? God is the origin. Vedanta Sutra also says, the absolute truth is he from whom everything is generating. The absolute truth is the supreme life, and from him all life is coming. What evidence do we have of a dead stone giving birth to a man or animals? Shyamasundar Das. Alexander felt that in the future, the race of man will evolve into super-conscious beings, into demigods. Srila Prabhupada. No, we have no information of this. Why is he so anxious about the planet Earth? These superconscious beings are already existing on Siddhaloka, Gandharvaloka, and many other higher planets. There are millions of planets with superhuman beings. From the Shastras we learn that the inhabitants of Siddhaloka can fly from one planet to another without the aid of a space vehicle. Shyamasundar Das. Alexander proposes that nature develops bodies to that point. Srila Prabhupada. No, bodies never develop in that way. There are different types of bodies, and the soul takes shelter of a particular type, selecting bodies just as a person selects clothes in a store. When we are within a suit, the suit moves. Bodies are selected according to the soul's desires. By your karma, you get a particular type of body. You have already discussed this. Shyamasundar Das. Then demigods will not evolve on this planet in the natural course of things? Srila Prabhupada. No. Shyamasundar Das. How is genius accounted for? Srila Prabhupada. When one is born a genius, we must understand that in his previous life, he cultivated a particular faculty, and that knowledge is being manifested in this life. In Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says that if a yogi does not complete the yoga process, he is given another chance. Bhagavad Gita 6th chapter verse 41. It is not that these things happen accidentally. Shyamasundar Das. Then through the practice of yoga, a higher consciousness can be developed? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, for instance, we are practicing bhakti yoga to develop Krishna consciousness. As far as your spiritual development is concerned, you must understand that you are spirit soul. Then you can qualify yourself to return to the spiritual world. There you can associate with the Lord and engage in spiritual activities. The Shastras tell us that we should try for spiritual perfection and not waste our time endeavoring for material comforts. Material comforts and distresses automatically come. There is no need in wasting time striving for them. In nature, there are many millions of living entities without business or profession, yet they are living, eating, sleeping, mating, and defending. These things will come automatically. Our endeavor should be for spiritual emancipation. Shyamasundara Das. According to Alexander, on the mental level, we are capable of enjoying objects and receiving pleasure from them, but we cannot understand them as they are. On the higher level, we can contemplate objects and understand them as they are, as well as enjoy them. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, that is our philosophy. A common man may see a rose and think, "Oh, I will offer this nice flower to my girlfriend." But when a devotee sees a rose, he thinks, "Oh, how wonderfully God's energy is acting." He understands that it is through Krishna's energy that such a wonderful flower exists, and therefore he knows that the flower should be offered to Krishna. After all, since Krishna produced it, it is Krishna's property. After offering the rose to Krishna, the devotee smells it. Then it is prasadam, the Lord's mercy. This is higher consciousness. Lower consciousness thinks, "Let me pick it and enjoy it." That is mere enjoyment without understanding. An animal eats just as man eats, but a man should have sufficiently developed consciousness to understand that what he is eating is given by Krishna. The Vedas state, "Eko bahunam yo vidadati kaman." The Supreme Lord is supplying all necessities of life to everyone. Katha Upanishad 2, 2nd chapter, verse 13. When one understands that Krishna is supplying everything, he thinks, "First, let me offer this to Krishna." If everything is not offered in sacrifice to the Supreme Lord, we will be entangled. Higher consciousness is mature consciousness. It is like a flower that has blossomed and is emitting a fragrance. That full blossom of consciousness is Krishna consciousness. Shyamasundara Das. Alexander believes that the entire world is moving to that point. Srila Prabhupada. Well, nature is giving us the chance. But because we have independence, we may or may not take the opportunity. Shyamasundara Das. Will only certain individuals attain that higher consciousness, or will the whole world attain it? Srila Prabhupada. That is a nonsensical question. Sometimes rascals inquire, "Swamiji, if everyone becomes God-conscious and goes back to Godhead, then who will remain here?" What is the meaning of such a nonsensical question? Why is a fool anxious for everyone? Why is he not anxious for himself? It is the same to ask, if everyone is honest, then who will go to jail? As if maintaining the jail is a very important business. Shyamasundara Das. During Alexander's day, people were very optimistic about man's future, thinking that everyone would be benefited by scientific discoveries. Srila Prabhupada. People think that by nature's way, they will be promoted, that once they have attained the status of man, they cannot be degraded. But if one can go up, he can also go down. The rich man can become poor again. Theosophists and others think that everything goes up, progresses. They don't even have the common sense to look around them. Hayagriva Das. Alexander distinguished between deity and God himself. For him, deity is a relative term for the next highest level of existence. For an ant, a dog may be a deity. For a dog, a man may be a deity. For a man, a demigod may be a deity. Deity is always one evolutionary step ahead of us. Alexander defines God as the being which possesses deity in full. That is, God is always one step ahead of every creature. Srila Prabhupada. He does not know the exact Vedic science of God, but as a philosopher he is suggesting a very nice method. For an ant, a bird is a deity. For a bird, a cat is a deity. And so on, according to one's position. And if you continue searching, you will find someone who has no one to worship. The ant must worship the bird worship the cat, and so on. But when we arrive at a person who has no one to worship, we have arrived at God. In the lower stages, there are always higher living beings. But when we come to the highest living being, we come to God Himself. This is explained in the Vedic literatures. Ishvara Parama Krishna Satchitananda Vigraha Anadir Adir Govinda Sarva Karana Karanam. Krishna, who is known as Govinda, is the Supreme Godhead. He has an eternal, blissful spiritual body. He is the origin of all. He has no other origin, and He is the prime cause of all causes. Brahma Samhita, 5th chapter, verse 1. And in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Mata parataram nanyat kinchid asti dananjaya. Mayi sarvam idam protam sutre mani gana iva. O conqueror of wealth, there is no truth superior to me. Everything rests upon me as pearls are strung on a thread. Bhagavad Gita 7th chapter verse 7. There is no authority superior to Krishna. As long as one has a superior, he is not God, but a servant of God. Shyamasundara Das. Alexander believes that lower organisms strive to emulate higher. Animals strive to become like men, and men strive to become like gods. Srila Prabhupada. There is no question of striving. It is by nature's way that the lower animals come to the platform of men. The living entity evolves from one life form to another, but this is with the help of nature. This law holds up to the human platform. Having developed consciousness, the human being has the power of discrimination. Originally, the soul is given independence. Krishna tells Arjuna, "Whatever you like, you do." Bhagavad Gita, 18th chapter, verse 63. God is the super soul, and we are the jiva souls subordinate to Him. Therefore, we are called tatashta, which means that we are marginal. We can go either way. We may take God's side or Maya's side. That is our choice. When we don't want to serve God, we are sent to Maya to serve her. Man's position as a subordinate remains the same, but in Maya he thinks, I am the master. This is just like a child trying to act against his father's wishes. When he is given a chance to do as he likes, the child thinks, oh, I am independent now. Actually, he is never independent, but he thinks that he is. When death comes, no one is independent. Although man continually serves Maya life after life, he still thinks of himself as independent. Only when we surrender to Krishna do we enjoy our real independence. Shyamasundara Das. But don't lower forms try to emulate higher ones? Srila Prabhupada. That is natural. Everyone wants a higher position because everyone is trying to be master. That is the whole problem. He can be a master to some extent, a head clerk in an office, a president, or prime minister. There is much ambition in the material world because materialistic men are guided by the idea that I shall become like Krishna. When their efforts fail in the material world, they strive to merge into Krishna. This is Mayavadi philosophy, not knowing that they are already Brahman, spirit soul. They consider themselves the Supreme Brahman, God Himself. Therefore they sit and meditate, thinking, I am moving the sun, I am moving the moon. This is simply imagination. This is the last snare of Maya. Maya, first of all, allures us to become a big merchant, a prime minister, a president. Maya is always saying, become this, become that, become, become. Maya is always telling us to work under her direction. Finally, she says, now you have failed in all these things. It is better now that you become God and attain your real status again. So the living entity begins to think, I am God, but Maya is still kicking him. As soon as this so-called God gets some toothache, he runs to the doctor. He does not stop to think, what kind of God am I? Shyamasundar Das. But what is that urge for promotion? Srila Prabhupada. It is not the individual's urge. Nature is giving the impetus. For instance, when you were a child, there was no sex urge. But when you attained adolescence, immediately the sex urge became manifest. Similarly, the perfection of consciousness is there, but unless you come to the platform of human life, it will not develop. Shyamasundar Das. Is there also an urge among lower animals to improve themselves, to be promoted? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, but all that is being carried out by nature. That is evolution. Darwin has taken this idea from the Vedas, but he has no idea of the soul. The only business of animals is eating, sleeping, mating, and defending. You may call this the struggle for existence. They are simply trying to live. They have no other ambition. If a man, having attained the human stage, is interested only in these things, he is no better than an animal. Nowadays, these are being taught by modern civilization. They teach you how to live comfortably with a car, a bungalow, a girlfriend, and restaurants. All living entities in this material world have the propensity to enjoy. On one platform, the living entity enjoys certain types of pleasure, but he is always wanting more. It is the spirit of material enjoyment that brings about the disease of materialistic life. Shyamasundar Das. So the urge to advance is perverted by the urge to enjoy? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, perverted. The living entity's position is to serve Krishna. But instead, he is serving his senses and thinking that he is enjoying. You can see how everyone is working hard day and night in order to enjoy. Everyone is thinking that he will be happy if he just becomes a millionaire. Animals work hard to get some food, and as soon as they acquire food, they are satisfied. But human beings are not so easily satisfied. They are so passionate that they are constantly working very hard to be happy. People do not understand that in material life, they cannot be happy in any position. Shyamasundar Das. Can the urge to advance be the desire to become godly? Srila Prabhupada. Desire means that one has lost his real happiness, dancing with God like the gopis. Ananda Mayo Byasat. The Vedanta Sutra says that by nature the living entity wants ananda, bliss. Because he seeks ananda in a perverted way, he is confused and frustrated. Therefore he thinks, not this state, but that will give me happiness. However, when he goes to his desired state, he again finds unhappiness. This is because he is seeking ananda in a perverted way. In Vaikuntha Loka there is eternal happiness because everyone is surrendered to Krishna. In Vrindavan, all the cowherd boys, gopis, cows, trees, and other living entities are centered about Krishna. They are all concerned with making Krishna happy. Only on that platform will we avoid confusion and frustration. Shyamasundar Das. Alexander says that at this point we cannot know the qualities of the next stage of evolution. Srila Prabhupada, he may not know, but we know. One who has Krishna as his master and teacher knows everything. Yasmin vijyate sarvam eva vijyatam bhavanti. If you understand Krishna, you understand everything. Hayagrivadas. Again, concerning the conception of deity, which is so central, Alexander writes, "The infinitude of God's deity marks the difference between him and all other empirical beings. Not only is God infinite in extent and duration, but his deity is also infinite in both respects." Srila Prabhupada, if God is infinite deity, he is not subject to created living beings. It is incorrect to think of God's deity as one of the deities within this material world. A person who thinks in this way is condemned as a mudha. Because I appear as an ordinary human being, Krishna tells us, mudhas, asses, consider me an ordinary human. Bhagavad Gita, 9th chapter, verse 11. Hayagrivadas. Alexander states that God is both body and soul, and that his soul is his deity. All finites are included in him, he writes, and are fragments of God's body, though their individuality is not lost in it. God is an individual being, just as a man or any other finite is, only that he is infinite. Srila Prabhupada, that is right. God is a person, but not like us. People mistake him to be like an ordinary human being, but this is due to illusion. Krishna is infinite, and Arjuna is finite. It is explained in Bhagavad Gita that Krishna, being infinite, knows everything in the past, present, and future. Bhagavad Gita, 4th chapter, verse 5. That is one of the differences between an ordinary living entity and God. The living entity forgets, but God does not. Hayagrivadas. Alexander sees God's body as neither spaceless nor timeless, for it is space-time itself. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, since everything emanates from him, there is nothing separate from him. God includes everything. Everything is part and parcel of God. The Mayavadis say that everything is one, but they do not accept the variety. The wheel is one, but there are different parts, the rim, the spokes, and the hub. Hayagrivadas. Alexander writes, "Now the body of God is the whole universe, and there is no body outside his. For him, therefore, all objects are internal, and the distinction of organic and special senses disappears." Srila Prabhupada. For the impersonalists who are not familiar with the personal form of God, Arjuna in Bhagavad Gita requested Krishna to show his universal form, the Virat Rupa. Arjuna himself was accepting the person Krishna as the supreme, but he knew that those with a poor fund of knowledge would not accept him. For this reason, in the 11th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, the universal form of God is very elaborately explained. However, we should understand that since the universal form was shown by Krishna, Krishna is the originator. It is not that the universal form is the origin. It was manifested by Krishna, and Lord Krishna's natural form is that of Krishna himself. The universal form is a feature. This is also confirmed in Bhagavad Gita. Aham sarvasya prabhavo mata sarvam pravartate. I am the source of all spiritual and material worlds. Everything emanates from me. Bhagavad Gita, 10th chapter, verse 8. Since everything emanates from him, the universal form has also emanated from him. One who understands this becomes Krishna's devotee. Hayagrivadas. For Alexander, Theism is equated with personalism, and pantheism with impersonalism. He writes, "For theism, God is an individual being distinct from the finite beings which make up the whole world. For pantheism, God is immanent in the universe of finite things." Srila Prabhupada. When we cannot understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead, God is impersonal. The sunshine is impersonal, but the sun god is in the background. Because we are on a lower platform, we cannot talk with the sun god. We can experience only the sunshine. Similarly, the expansion of God's energy is impersonal, but the personality is in the background. Because we are in the material energy, we are not in direct touch with God, and therefore we say that God is impersonal. If we become devotees, we can talk with God in person, just as the cowherd boys and girls did in Vrindavan. It is also stated, Nicho Nichanam Chaitanash Chaitananam, Katha Upanishad 2, 2nd chapter, verse 13. God is an eternal living being, and we are also eternal living beings. Yet he is different from us in that he is the chief. He has arranged everything for us in both the material and spiritual worlds. He has given us air, water, and fire in order to live. He is the maintainer, and we are subordinate jivas. Hayagriva Das. Alexander seems to acknowledge both theistic and pantheistic views. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, as I said, because water has come from God, we say that it is God's semen. Because light has come from him, we say that the sun is his eye. In that everything is an emanation from God, everything is related to God. In any case, the impersonal features are subordinate to the personal. Maya tatam idam sarvam jagad avyakta murtina matstani sarva bhutani na chaham teshva avashtita. By me, in my unmanifested form, this entire universe is pervaded. All beings are in me, but I am not in them. Bhagavad Gita, 9th chapter, verse 4. Just as the sunshine depends on the sun itself, so the entire cosmic manifestation depends on God. Krishna says that although everything is resting on him, he is personally not present. Queen Kunti also says, "You are within and without, yet fools cannot see you." These verses, spoken by Queen Kunti, are given in Srimad Bhagavatam. Namasye Purusham Tvadyam Ishvaram Prakrite Param Alakshyam Sarva Bhutanam Antar Bahir Avashtitam Maya Javani Kachanam Agya Dokshajam Avyayam Na Lakshase Muta Drisha Nato Natya Daroyata Tata Paramaham Sanam Muninam Amalatmanam Bhakti Yoga Vidanartam Katam Pashyema Hi Striya. O Krishna, I offer my obeisances unto you, because you are the original personality and are unaffected by the qualities of the material world. You are existing both within and without everything, yet you are invisible to all. Being beyond the range of limited sense perception, you are the eternally irreproachable factor covered by the curtain of deluding energy. You are invisible to the foolish observer, exactly as an actor dressed as a player is not recognizable. You yourself descend to propagate the transcendental science of devotional service unto the hearts of the advanced transcendentalists and mental speculators, who are purified by being able to discriminate between matter and spirit. How then can we women know you perfectly? Srimad Bhagavatam, 1st Canto, Chapter 8, verses 18 to 20. This is a very good example. Krishna is playing on the stage, and his son is seeing him. And another friend is saying, "Do you see your father?" But the son does not recognize his father. A devotee can understand, but a speculator with limited sense perception cannot. Hayagrivadas. Alexander writes, "It is not so much that God is in everything, but rather that everything is in God." Srila Prabhupada. "Since there is nothing but God, how can anything be without God? Since everything is God's expansion, how can we be sometimes with God and sometimes without Him? When we are not in God, we are in Maya. But Maya is also God's. It is illusion to think that we are without God." Hayagrivadas. After analyzing both theism and pantheism, the personal and impersonal, Alexander finds them both defective in themselves. But he concludes, if a choice must be made, it is theistic. Srila Prabhupada. This means that when one comes to the personal aspect of God, he sees that everything refers to God and that there is nothing independent. To the unintelligent, it appears that the cosmic manifestation is different from Bhagavan, but actually nothing can exist without the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Hayagrivadas. At times, Alexander takes the Aristotelian view in maintaining that there is no reciprocal action from God. For though we speak, as we inevitably must, in human terms of God's response to us, there is no direct experience of that response, except through our own feeling that devotion to God or worship carries with it its own satisfaction. Srila Prabhupada. This means that he does not understand God's omnipotence. God is omnipotent, and he comes before Arjuna to speak Bhagavad Gita. Being all-powerful, God can come and speak to his devotee. If he cannot, what is the meaning of his omnipotence? Krishna reciprocates with the advanced devotees. Tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yena mam upayantite. To those who are constantly devoted and worship me with love, I give the understanding by which they can come to me. Bhagavad Gita, 10th chapter, verse 10. God talks to his devotee who is fully in love with him, but he does not talk with ordinary men. Premanjana Charita Bhakti Vilochanena Santa Sadaiva Hridayeshu Vilokayanti Yam Shamasundaram Achintya Gunas Varupam Govindam Adi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. I worship the primeval Lord, Govinda, who is always seen by the devotee, whose eyes are anointed with the pulp of love. He is seen in his eternal form of Shamasundar, situated within the heart of the devotee. Brahma Samhita, 5th chapter, verse 38. Just as a king talks with his immediate officers and ministers, and not with the ordinary man in the street, God personally talks to his devotees, but not to the non-devotees or atheists. We understand that Krishna talked to the gopis and gopas in Vrindavan and reciprocated with his parents, Mother Yashoda and Maharaj Nanda. The cowherd boys who played with Krishna amassed many pious activities in their previous lives to arrive at a position where they could play with God. This is not an ordinary position. People generally think that such play is inconceivable. But when we come to that platform of devotion, we can play with God, ride on God's shoulders, and talk with Him just as with an ordinary friend. Of course, one comes to that position of perfection after many millions of pious births. Hayagrivadas. Within the same book, Space, Time, and Deity, Alexander contradicts himself on this issue of reciprocation. God reciprocates the worship man pays him, and the confidence he reposes in him. He writes, There is always the double relationship of need. If man wants God and depends upon him, God wants man and is so far dependent. Srila Prabhupada. God is not dependent on anyone. God is independent. But that statement is acceptable in the sense that sometimes God wants to become dependent. That is according to his pleasure. Sometimes he accepts some of his devotees in ways that he can depend on them. He became dependent on Mother Yashoda, just as an ordinary child becomes dependent on his mother. Although everything is dependent on God, and he is not dependent on anyone, he takes pleasure in this kind of relationship. Hayagriva Das. I don't think Alexander understood it in that way. Srila Prabhupada. This is not a very ordinary thing to understand. It cannot be understood by mental speculation. Hayagriva Das. Alexander also writes that God himself is involved in our acts and their issues. Not only does he matter to us, but we matter to him. Is this actually so? Srila Prabhupada. Yes, although we are sons of God, we are fallen, conditioned souls and are suffering. Therefore, God is very compassionate, and he comes personally to teach us. He says, "Why are you rotting in this material world? Surrender to me and go back to Godhead. Then you will be happy." God is the father of everyone, and it is natural for a father to be concerned about his sons. Presently, we are conditioned by material nature because we are disobedient. God, being the Supreme Father, feels for our suffering. But he is not suffering. The devotees of God also feel for the conditioned souls, and Krishna's devotees are very dear to him because they are trying to spread his instructions, Bhagavad Gita. The devotees are acting on behalf of God to deliver conditioned souls. Shyama Sundar Das. Alexander believed that man, being part of God, is capable of cooperating with God to make further progress in the universe. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, that is real life, cooperating with God. But in this material world, man is uncooperative. Krishna says, "Surrender unto me," but no one wants to do this. Even when people attain the highest levels of human life, wherein their karma is regulated and they possess knowledge and yogic abilities, they still will not surrender to Krishna. Krishna bhakta niskama ataiva shanta bhuti mukti siddhi kami sakali ashanta. Because a devotee of Lord Krishna is desireless, he is peaceful. Fruitive workers desire material enjoyment, jnanis desire liberation, and yogis desire material opulence. Therefore, they are all lusty and cannot be peaceful. Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Lila, Chapter 19, Verse 149. The karmis want sense enjoyment, the jnanis want mukti, liberation, and the yogis want yoga siddhis, the yoga powers. All these people are demanding various things, sense gratification, liberation, mystic powers. Only the Krishna Bhakta makes no demands. He says, "Dear Lord, I am your eternal servitor. I surrender unto you. Now do whatever you like with me." Bhoktaram yagya tapasam sarva loka maheshvaram suridam sarva bhutanam gyatva mam shantim richati. The sages, knowing me as the ultimate purpose of all sacrifices and austerities, the supreme lord of all planets and demigods, and the benefactor and well-wisher of all living entities, attain peace from the pangs of material miseries. Bhagavad Gita, 5th chapter, verse 29. By understanding that Krishna is the supreme enjoyer, the supreme proprietor, and the supreme friend, we can become shanta, peaceful. Shyama Sundar Das. Alexander felt that man should cooperate with God in order to usher in a higher stage of consciousness, the next stage of evolution. This is man's responsibility. Srila Prabhupada. But what is the next stage of evolution? When man is prepared to cooperate with God, he has already attained the highest position. Unfortunately, no one wants to cooperate. There is simply enjoyment. There is no more evolution. If you come to the point of worshiping the Supreme Lord, there is no question of evolution. You have already attained the highest form of evolution. Mam cha yo bhya bicharena bhakti yogena sevate sa gunan samatityaitan brahma bhuyaya kalpate. One who engages in full devotional service, who does not fall down in any circumstance, at once transcends the modes of material nature and thus comes to the level of Brahman. Bhagavad Gita, 14th chapter, verse 26. The Brahman platform is already attained. He doesn't have to strive to become Brahman. He immediately transcends the three gunas and comes to the platform of spirit. Without being Brahman, how can you serve the Supreme Brahman? Alexander speaks of the higher stages of evolution, but he has no real knowledge of them. According to the Vaishnava philosophy, there are five basic stages: Shanta, Dasya, Sakya, Vatsalya, and Madhurya. When you attain the Brahma-Bhuta stage and understand that you are not the body, but spirit-soul, you have attained the Shanta platform. On that platform you think, "Oh, God is so great." From the Shanta stage, you can progress to the Dasya stage, wherein you realize that God is so great that some service must be rendered to Him. In the Sakya stage, you not only know that God is great and render service to God, but you also serve God as a friend, like Arjuna. On the Vatsalya platform, service is rendered to Krishna as a father or a mother. Yashoda, for instance, rendered service to Krishna as a mother, and she was always thinking, "Krishna is hungry, I must feed him. I must protect him from monkeys and fire." On the platform of Madhurya Ras, the highest platform, you can enter into intimate pastimes with Krishna. Although there are many stages in spiritual life, there is actually no difference between them. It is not that those who serve Krishna as friends are inferior to Radharani, who serves Krishna as his consort. Shyamasundardas. Alexander sees the freedom of the will operating as an activity, not subject to extraneous forces. It is the expression of a person acting to serve not only his own interests, but those of society as well. Srila Prabhupada. In a state, a citizen also cooperates in two ways. When he does not break the law, he cooperates as a free citizen. And when he breaks the law, he cooperates by going to prison. He either cooperates by free will or by force. Forceful cooperation is inferior. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, "Jivera Svarupa Haya Krishnara Nichidas, Krishnara Tatashta Shakti, Beda Beda Prakasha, Suryamsha Kirana Yaiche Agni Jvala Chaya, Sva Bhavika Krishnara Tina Prakara Shakti Haya." It is the living entity's constitutional position to be an eternal servant of Krishna, because he is the marginal energy of Krishna, and a manifestation simultaneously one and different from the Lord, like a molecular particle of sunshine or fire. Krishna has three varieties of energy. Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Lila, chapter 20, verses 108 to 109. By his constitutional position, the living entity is the eternal servant of Krishna. In the Vaikuntha planets, cooperation is voluntary, and here in this material world, cooperation is forced. In the material world, we are serving Maya, working under her force. We can avoid that force only by voluntarily cooperating with Krishna. Daivi hiesha gunamai, mama maya dharachaya, mam eva ye prapadyante, mayam etam tarantite. This divine energy of mind, consisting of the three modes of material nature, is difficult to overcome. But those who have surrendered unto me can easily cross beyond it. Bhagavad Gita 7th chapter verse 14. Automatic cooperation is bhakti, and forced cooperation is karma. These may appear to be the same, but they are not. The karmi may be typing, and the bhakta may be typing. But the karmi is typing under the force of maya, to earn money for sense gratification. And the bhakta is typing for the glorification of Krishna. The activity is the same, but the consciousness is different. Shyamasundar Das. Alexander believed that when one has attained the higher levels of evolution, he can see that everything on the lower levels is determined. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, for instance, we should not try to improve our economic condition, because it is already decided. Why is one man born rich and another born to work so hard? Srimad Bhagavatam, 1st Canto, 5th Chapter, verse 18, says that we should not strive hard for material happiness, because material happiness and distress come automatically. An intelligent man utilizes his time to develop his Krishna consciousness. Shyamasundar Das. Alexander accepted Plato's three greatest values in life, truth, beauty, and goodness, as values to be accepted by the majority. Srila Prabhupada. Unfortunately, in the material world, no one likes the truth. At least in this age, the majority of people are not truthful. As soon as one becomes truthful, he becomes a Brahmin. Where are the Brahmins in this age? Kalo Shudra Sambhava. In Kali Yuga, everyone is a Shudra. If Alexander thinks that everyone will accept truthfulness as a great value, he is mistaken. Shyamasundar Das. For Alexander, there is a practical criterion for truth, but he preferred the coherence principle by which the majority opinion determined truth by mutual agreement. Srila Prabhupada. Because he is European, he is thinking in a democratic way. The hard fact is that truth is not accepted by ordinary men. Truth is truth. Either it is in your mind or not, truth is absolute. Only highly elevated persons can understand the truth. Out of many truthful men, perhaps only one can understand Krishna as he is. Shyamasundar Das. Alexander defines a good person as one who integrates and controls his impulses for the best interest of himself and society. Srila Prabhupada. This is also described in Vedic literatures. Tapasa Brahmacharyena Shamena Cha Damena Cha Tyagena Satya Shochapyam Yamena Niyamena Va. To concentrate the mind, one must observe a life of celibacy and not fall down. One must undergo the austerity of voluntarily giving up sense enjoyment. One must then control the mind and senses, give charity, be truthful, clean, and nonviolent. Follow the regulative principles, and regularly chant the holy name of the Lord. Srimad Bhagavatam, 6th Canto, 1st Chapter, verse 13. These are the processes by which we may become perfect. But if we become devotees of Krishna, we immediately attain all the good qualities. Yas yasti bhaktir bhagavati akinchana sarvar gunais tatra samasate sura. All the demigods and their exalted qualities, such as religion, knowledge, and renunciation, become manifest in the body of one who has developed unalloyed devotion for the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Srimad Bhagavatam, 5th Canto, 18th Chapter, verse 12. Shyamasundar Das. In the second sense of the word good, Alexander says that whatever enhances man's welfare or happiness is good. Srila Prabhupada, that is not necessarily so. One may open hospitals to help people, but spreading Krishna consciousness is greater welfare work. What is really good for a man is Krishna bhakti, nothing else. Shyamasundar Das. Alexander maintains that goodness consists of modifications in the environment that will aid man in his spiritual pursuits. Srila Prabhupada. That is what we are trying to do in this Krishna consciousness movement. It is not that everyone can follow the regulative principle strictly. We are proposing that people chant Hare Krishna. Whatever the situation, somehow or other, we must engage our mind in Krishna. Rupa Goswami said, Yena tena prakarena mana krishne niveshayat. Never mind the rules and regulations, just fix your mind on Krishna. As soon as you become Krishna conscious, the regulative principles will be your servants. Hayagriva Das. As for the existence of evil and suffering in the world, Alexander writes, God is not responsible for the miseries endured in working out his providence, but rather we are responsible for our acts. Srila Prabhupada. Yes, we create our own miserable condition, just as a silkworm creates a cocoon, becomes entrapped, and dies. Ashradadana purusha dharmasyasya parantapa aprapya mam nivartante mrityu samsara vartmani. Those who are not faithful in the path of devotional service cannot attain me, O conqueror of foes, but return to birth and death in this material world. Bhagavad Gita, 9th chapter, verse 3. Because a living entity acts independently, not caring for God's instructions, he is entangled and he suffers. In this way, he creates his own suffering.